टुडे वी हैव टू एक्सपर्ट्स टू डिस्कस दी इश्यूज टू माय राइट प्रोफेसर श्रीधर द्विवेदी ही इज प्रोफेसर एंड हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मेडिसिन एट UCMS एंड GTB हॉस्पिटल ही हैज बीन इन्वॉल्व इन दिस प्रोग्राम एज ए कोर्स राइटर एंड ऑल्सो द कोर्स एडिटर इन डिजाइनिंग प्रोसेस ऑल्सो हिज कंट्रीब्यूशन इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट हिज मेन इंटरेस्ट इज प्रिवेंटिव कार्डियोलॉजी ही विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट इलेक्ट्रोकार्डियोग्राफी टूडे To the extreme right, Dr. S. B. Madhu, he is professor in the Department of Medicine in the UCMS and GTB Hospital. His main area of interest is endocrinology and metabolism. He has his specialization in diabetes. So we will be benefited by his experience in diabetes and he will be taking the main session on diabetes. We will be discussing our session now on hypertension. Now I will request Dr. Dibedi. Can we have the discussion start?
Well, as you are aware that the hypertension is a very common problem among the elderly. Before deciding that which of the elderly is a hypertensive, we have to know what really is the hypertension. The hypertension is defined when the systolic blood pressure is 120 millimeter of mercury or more, and or the diastolic blood pressure is 90 millimeter of mercury or more. This is the basic understanding which we should have whenever we are going to decide about the hypertension in an elderly. Second thing is that once we have taken the blood pressure in an elderly, we must record it at least on two or three occasions, and that too in a relaxed atmosphere. And every time we should record this blood pressure, and average of the three blood pressure is usually taken to decide whether the patient is having hypertension or not. And once having decided that this patient is hypertensive, we have to grade him which kind of hypertension he is having. Which stage of hypertension is having. The normal blood pressure is somewhere around 120 systolic blood pressure and 80 diastolic blood pressure. And then there is a stage of pre-hypertension where the patient may be having systolic blood pressure of 120 to 139 and diastolic blood pressure ranging somewhere 80 to 89. This is also very important. This is a new recognition of another class by JNC7. And then we have stage 1 hypertension where the blood pressure is, the systolic blood pressure is more than 140 and less than 160, somewhere between 140 to 159, and the diastolic is between 90 to 99. And then there is stage 2 hypertension which is defined when the systolic blood pressure is 160 or more than 160 and the diastolic blood pressure is 100 or more than 100. This is a radical departure from the previous classification, JNC 6 classification, where there were three stages and there was nothing like pre-hypertension. This recognition is very important because it has been observed that those patients who are having pre-hypertension, means the systolic blood pressure somewhere between 121 to 139, these are the people who will later on develop hypertension, and these are the people who might be getting more complication, more mortality, increased mortality and morbidity in their later life. That is the reason that we have recognized another newer entity like pre-hypertension. Second thing is that there is stage 3 has been taken away, has been merged into stage 2 in the new JNC7 Joint National Classification. Now, whenever you measure the BP in an elderly, you should be careful that BP in an elderly is very variable. It might be on the extremes because their arteries are stiff and they have lost their elasticity. And there is always a chance of a postural change in an elderly. And So the blood pressure should be recorded in standing position as well as in sitting position. The third thing is there is, and this postural change is more after meals and more after exercise in elderly people. And then there is an entity called pseudo hypertension. The blood pressure which you are recording by the cuff might be recording a higher blood pressure than what really is the blood pressure in these cases. So that is called pseudo because the arteries are stiff and calcified. And fourth thing is there is a reversible form of hypertension in elderly. So these are very important things which one must take into account whenever you are taking the blood pressure in an elderly. In nutshell, you must always record the blood pressure in elderly in sitting position as well as in the standing position. That fourth, which is very important from risk stratification of the hypertension in elderly, the recognition of the systolic blood pressure or what is called isolated systolic hypertension. Initially, people were thinking that the diastolic hypertension is more important rather than systolic hypertension. But in cases of elderly people, systolic blood pressure is far more important than the diastolic blood pressure. And it has a lot of bearing in the risk stratification of the hypertension. Now, if you talk about hypertension, and when we say that the hypertension is a very common problem, so let us just dwell upon how common is this hypertension in worldwide. The worldwide prevalence of the hypertension is somewhere about 1 billion population of the total world is suffering from hypertension. And then 7.1 million of deaths occur due to the hypertension in the whole year. And when we talk of India, our population as of now is around 1080 million, and 60% of people who are above 18 years, they are much more liable to develop hypertension, and this 60% is somewhere works around 636 million of the people, out of which 362 million of the people are in rural population and 254 million population is in urban. So according to a conservative estimate, we have total 89 million people who are suffering from hypertension in this country, because it is said that the prevalence of the hypertension in urban population is around 25%, and 10% of the rural population is having hypertension. But if you add to this figure the pre-hypertensive people, then this figure becomes very enormous. About 180 million of the people are suffering from pre-hypertension. So you can imagine 180 million people pre-hypertensive and 89 million people suffering from hypertension. This is a large chunk of the people which are having hypertension. And once we have discussed about hypertension, let me also dwell upon that in elderly, the hypertension does not come alone. It is usually associated with lot of comorbid condition. And let us take few examples to illustrate this point. So a person who was 70 years old male, a JK migrant, he came under very severe stressful condition to this place, and then he developed type 2 diabetes mellitus, and subsequently he developed coronary artery disease, atrial fibrillation, and then he started showing signs of hypertension, then dysuria because of benign prostatic hypertrophy, then he had diminished hearing, then he has flatulence because of the gallbladder stone, then also he has amnesia, insomnia and anxiety. So hypertension is not a lone figure, not a lone problem in elderly people. Most of the time it is associated with certain other problems also. Let us take another example. This is a 62-year-old ex-army male who was a chronic smoker, used to smoke very heavily, 40 cigarettes per day, 6 cigarettes per day for last 40 years, had palpitation, and then his blood pressure was recorded to be 200 by 140. He also had dyspnea because of the chronic obstructive pulmonary airway disease. He has hoarseness of voice, which was later on found to be because of the laryngeal leukoplakia. He also had oral leukoplakia. Then he developed acute chest discomfort when he came to the hospital, and which was found to be because of non-ST elevated MI. Then in CT it was found that he had main left and LAD calcification. So hypertension is here one of the comorbid conditions. There are so many other comorbid conditions also. We will take up another example in an elderly. This is a female who had, at the age of the 72, this female had come to us with knee joint replacement, and knee joint replacement, it was found that there was a pus. She was a known hypothyroid lady. She has hypertension. She was detected to have hypertension. She was detected to have diabetes. She also had depression, obesity, and she was to be put for operation. An elderly who has so many problems. So these elderly people usually have lot of comorbid condition. Having realized this, that hypertension is frequently associated with comorbid conditions, we have to think of other things. What are the other risk factors for the hypertension? And before going on that, let us also discuss how age is related with hypertension. More than half people in between the age bracket of the 60 to 69 are found to have hypertension. More than 3/4 of the people who are 70 and above are found to have hypertension. And there is a 3-4 increase in the cardiovascular disease in the elderly when it is elderly are found to have hypertension. And hypertension, as I said to you before, is associated with multiple health problems, like hypertension may have coronary artery disease, may have cerebrovascular disease, may have type 2 diabetes mellitus, may also have rheumatic heart disease. A rheumatic heart disease patient who, if he becomes old, they are frequently found to have hypertension also. They may also, because of their hypertension, they may also found to have coronary artery disease. And chronic obstructive airway disease, because the elderly also tend to smoke, and because of the age again, they may tend to have malignancies. So hypertension associated with multiple health problems. Then coming to the risk factors associated with, this is another case with this slide illustrates that 74-year-old female who is a diabetic, as I was mentioning to you, who had hypertension, who had asymptomatic, because of the diabetes, she had asymptomatic enteroceptor myocardial infarction. Then she developed acute abdominal pain, which was thought to be because of the diabetic ketoacidosis, because she had ketonuria also, and the blood pressure, which was recorded, was found to be in the to the tune of 220/120 mm. So everything is important in management of this case. Of course, one has to bring down the blood pressure to a very quickly. One has to manage the diabetes in this case very quickly, because she is having diabetic ketoacidosis. At the same time, she is also having enteroceptor myocardial infarction. And before coming to the risk factors associated with hypertension, the common risk factors are type 2 diabetes mellitus, and then metabolic syndrome, and smoking. These are the common risk factors. Age, of course, notwithstanding, as I told you earlier, that anybody who is above 60, 2/3 of the people develop hypertension. Age above 70, 3/4 of the people having hypertension. Diabetes, again, makes one prone to have more hypertension. In fact, current day's philosophy is that diabetes, hypertension, and coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease, have been treated as coronary artery disease equivalent. Similarly, smoking makes prone to is a definite risk for the hypertension. In a very large series in healthy population study done at America recently, it has been found that those people who smoke very heavily or moderate smoker tend to have hypertension. And the smoking in another way produces, aggravates the problem of the hypertension. We will be discussing very shortly. And those persons whose family history in the family, the mother or the father or the siblings are hypertension, having hypertension, they are more prone for hypertension. Patients showing microalbuminuria, this is again considered to be a risk factor for the hypertension. If somebody is obese and his body mass index is more than 30 kilogram per meter square, body mass index is an index which is calculated from the body weight in kilogram upon height in meter square. Ideally, it should be 22 or below 22 in South Asian population. But if somebody is above 30, this body mass index is above 30, then it is definite risk for hypertension. We will again discuss an entity called metabolic syndrome, which also tells that hypertension, obesity and diabetes, these are part and parcel of the same endothelial dysfunction because of which patient may have hypertension. The physical inactivity. It has been found that the people who are not physically active people, who do not do any kind of physical activity, these are the people who suffer from the hypertension. And if these people are encouraged to have a walk, a regular walk, usually the prehypertension can in fact be treated by just encouraging the patient to walk more frequently. So physical and inactivity is another thing. Tobacco in any form, whether you take oral tobacco, whether you take pan masala, whether you do smoking, bidi smoking or cigarette smoking, then you are liable to have hypertension much more frequently than a person who has a non-smoker. Taking excess alcohol, this is again, taking alcohol one peg is considered to be a beneficial for hypertension, for coronary artery disease. But if somebody takes excess alcohol, then again one is liable to develop hypertension. And one of the important clinical dictum is that one of the important cause of reversible hypertension is taking excess of alcohol. So if you stop alcohol, the chances are that the hypertension, pre-hypertension or stage 1 hypertension can be brought under control. And obstructive sleep apnea. You must have observed that those elderly people who snore during sleep, they tend to have more hypertension, they are found to have more prevalence of the ischemic heart disease, they are found to have more cerebrovascular incidence. Then, after discussing the various risk factors, we will like to know what are the target organs which are involved in case of hypertension. The target organs which are involved in the hypertension is heart. Heart is the first organ which bears the brunt of the hypertension. And what happens in the heart? The heart size increases. And this increase in heart size can be noted by simply doing electrocardiography, and which is called left ventricular hypertrophy. Now, of course, echo has come. By echo also one can measure this increment in the heart, the cardiomegaly. Then those people who are hypertensive, they may have coronary artery disease, and this coronary artery disease may manifest as angina. It may culminate into myocardial infarction, or it may result into acute coronary insufficiency. This must be made clear that any patient who is having hypertension, it may go on silently, it may remain asymptomatic, and patient may present as a case of angina or myocardial infarction or acute coronary insufficiency. And that's why hypertension is said to be a silent killer in elderly population. And once the patient comes with MI, myocardial infarction, and you record the blood pressure in emergency, you found that the patient is having hypertension also. Or there is some indication that target organ damage in the hypertension. The next target organ which can be involved in hypertension is brain. And there it manifests as a stroke, whether a thrombotic stroke or a hemorrhagic stroke or in the form of dementia or in the form of lacunar infarct. And interestingly, you will find that those patients who are having hypertension, whose target organ heart is involved, they develop myocardial infarction. The other target organ which could be involved in hypertension is eyes, and which you can see in the fundus, there is evidence of hypertensive retinopathy. And rightly, the clinical dictum is the examination of a hypertensive individual, particularly so in an elderly, is incomplete until unless somebody has done the fundus evaluation. And in the fundus, there are several grades of the hypertensive retinopathy changes which can be observed. And sometimes the patient may come to you, a patient of hypertension may come to you with sudden blindness because of the retinal artery occlusion. So this is another presentation of the hypertension in an elderly. And other important target organ which could be included in, which can be affected in hypertension is kidney. And so the dictum is the examination of the hypertensive elderly is incomplete until unless you have done the urine examination, until unless you have done the complete kidney function test, that is blood urea, serum electrolyte and serum creatinine. And now with the advent of the ultrasonography, one should do the ultrasonographic evaluation of the kidney also to know the kidney size. And the next target organ which could be involved in hypertension is peripheral vascular system, because these hypertensives are much more prone to develop peripheral vascular disease. Having said so, let me again elaborate some point about smoking and hypertension, which is very important for elderly. The person who smoke, they are much more prone to get hypertension. They are 3 times more prone to get hypertension. But suppose if these people are having hypertension, at the same time they are also having high lipid value, they are 8 times more prone to get ischemic heart disease. But in case the person is a smoker also, has high lipids value also, has hypertension also, then he is almost 14 times more prone to develop hypertension. So smoking associated with hypertension, it has a multiplicative effect, because smoking tends to give rise to cholesterol, dyslipidemia. Smoking tends to give rise to hypertension. Smoking tends to give rise to coronary artery disease. And when this smoking joins hands with the hypertension and cholesterol, with elevated cholesterol, it tends to multiplicate the risk of the coronary artery disease in an individual. Similarly, another point which should be appreciated, the multiple metabolic syndrome and hypertension. What is metabolic syndrome in an elderly? Metabolic syndrome is basically a constellation of the features of the dyslipidemia, central obesity, hypertension and glucose intolerance. This is very important, because by just simply measuring the waist-hip ratio of an individual, you can diagnose, clinically suspect that the patient is having syndrome X. So whenever you come across any case of hypertension, please measure the waist length. Initially there was a concept that we must measure the waist circumference and the hip circumference and divide the waist circumference by the hip circumference. In the male it should be 0.9, in the female it should be somewhere around 0.8. But now the evidence has accumulated where it is said that you only measure the waist circumference. If in the male it is more than 102, the person is suspected to have abdominal obesity. If in the female it is more than 92, then a lady is suspected to having central obesity. But how come the central obesity or metabolic syndrome makes one prone to develop more hypertension or to develop complications of hypertension like coronary artery disease, or for that matter coronary artery disease? This is also very interesting, because metabolic syndrome produces changes at 3 or 4 levels. In insulin, it produces beta. In pancreas, it produces beta cell dysfunction. That's why glucose intolerance. In peripheral tissues, it produces fat breakdown, and that's why it produces dyslipidemia. In the heart, it produces coronary artery disease, and that's why simply speaking, this mechanism is very complex. But simply speaking, metabolic syndrome produces changes in the heart, produces changes in the lipids, produces changes in the pancreas, beta cells, and that's why it is this glucose intolerance. As I told you, waist circumference more than 102 in male, more than 88 in female. Blood pressure more than 130, systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure 85. It is just stage of prehypertension, almost bordering onto that. Glucose intolerance, blood sugar, fasting blood sugar more than 110 milligram per dl. Triglycerides more than 150 milligram per dl. Or HDL less than 40 in male and less than 50 in female. Out of these five things, if there are four abnormalities, then one is labeled as centrally obese, one is labeled as having this metabolic syndrome. This is NCEP, National Cholesterol Education Panel, ATP3 latest recommendation, which is now being followed in most of the countries. Having said so, now let us discuss something about the clinical aspect of the metabolic syndrome. Clinically, these patients of metabolic syndrome, as I have told you, they have 5 to 9-fold more risk of developing diabetes. Anybody who is having central obesity, they have 4-fold increase in the risk of the fatal coronary heart disease. They have 2-fold greater risk of developing cerebrovascular disease, and they have increased risk of coronary heart disease in women. Usually women are usually said to be immune from having a protective effect from the coronary artery disease. But those ladies who have a large waist-hip ratio, who are centrally obese, and who have other features of the metabolic syndrome, they have increased risk of developing coronary artery disease. And in addition to this, we must also know that association of body mass, this increased body mass index with the hypertension is statistically significant in patients who are having dyslipidemia, otherwise vice versa also. And this is also, you have controlled the age, the ethnicity, the socioeconomic status and the smoking. So whenever the hypertension and dyslipidemia is there and the person is having obesity, central obesity, this is in nutshell the central message of central obesity.